call Riley Gates to the stand? Please state your name for the court.
My name is Riley Gates.
And are you... Sorry. Did you conduct an investigation in this case?
Yes, I did.
And did you come to a conclusion with a reasonable degree of certainty within your field in this case?
Yes, I did.
What is that field?
Journalistic ethics.
And are you currently employed in that field?
Yes, I am.
What are you employed in?
I'm currently a senior professor at the University of California at Berkeley.
And did you go to college in state?
Of course. I attended Northwestern University for my bachelor's and the University of Minnesota for my master's, both in journalism.
Did you have anything published?
I have several books. The latest three are covering topics such as how the media is handling college trials.
What are the names of these ones?
One's titled Without Merit. The other one, Thorny Issue, about the Ashley Thornhill trial. And the third one is... The third one, I'm sorry if I have a title and I wrote it, covers the
That's okay, Mr. Gates. What's your past employment history?
I've worked at several universities. Since 1990, I've been employed by New York University, the University of Tokyo, McGill University, before joining the University of California at Berkeley.
And have you ever done anything other than teaching?
I've also done some side work as an expert in just the journalistic ethics for defamation cases.
How many cases have you worked on?
I have prepared reports in over 60, testified in over 20.
And are you a member of any professional societies?
I'm a member of three: the British Broadcasting Corporation, the Radio Television News Directors Association, and the Society for Journalistic Ethics.
And have you ever been recognized for your work?
I have received two awards, the Francis Leo Award and the Maurice Killings Award.
Can I have permission to proceed as witness as an expert?
Proceed.
Now, Mr. Payton, I would like to talk to you about the about the reason why you're here. What is your connection with this case?
I was hired by BNN in April of 2007.
And what were you hired for?
I was hired to conduct an investigation and then later write a report on the September 24th broadcast.
What did you use to determine it?
I used what the industry calls the rules and the tools of the trade.
What are these rules?
Rules of the journalism standards of ethics, a compilation of ethical standards from the Radio Television News Directors Association, as well as the British Broadcasting Corporation.
What are the tools that you use?
The tools are, in this case, the affidavits, the broadcast in both a transcript form and a video of it, the Fran Martin memo, along with the retraction issued by BNN.
Did you find any of these tools more significant than any other?
As with most defamation cases, the broadcast itself is the most significant piece of evidence.
Your Honor, permission to set the courtroom and refer to the what has been previously marked as Defendant Exhibit A and its Plaintiff Exhibit 2. Plaintiff Exhibit 2 in its form of form. The broadcast transcript is form of form.
Granted.
Do permission to have the witness step down from the stand and refer to this broadcast?
Granted.
Now, Mr. Faith, did you apply these standards when you were reviewing the broadcast?
Of course.
And what were these standards?
There was four primary standards in this case. The reporting on file, the reporter's use of his or her opinion, the use of sources, and the retraction that was issued by the interviewer.
Okay, and if you don't mind, could you please mark for the court what you found most remarkable in your reviews about how a reporter should report on a crime?
One of the primary elements of reporting on a crime is the use of eyewitnesses, especially those who are reliable. At the bottom of this first page, you see exactly where Eugene Thomas made mention of his eyewitnesses, especially the police.
Okay, and how did this apply to
the journalistic standard of ethics calls for using credible witnesses and to get the most reliable information as possible. Especially the police being the authority figures on the scene, these would normally be deemed highly reliable witnesses.
And who did he interview?
Between my research and the affidavits, when I was presented in the broadcast, I was able to talk to Nikki McQuiggan, the lead death investigator on the scene. He was also the forensics expert at the time. Harley Kim, his photojournalist, along with a brief passing with Jan Patel.
Now, are there any specific types of witnesses that a reporter should not interview?
Excuse me, Tom. Let's have him retake the witness stand that he's not actually referring to the monster.
Okay.
And you can get out permission to ask permission next time you need the witness to refer to the monster.
Okay. Would you
Yes, please.
Are there any types of witnesses that a reporter should not interview?
Unreliable witnesses, these generally be people who are either to get on television, whose accounts of events are highly unreliable, or otherwise who normally be what a normal person would say as something is wrong with this person, or what they are giving them the report.
Permission to have the witness lie back to the
I have a question for
you. Okay. What did you find, based on your review, what did you find most remarkable about how a reporter should use their opinion?
Well, there's still several standards in using an opinion. The biggest one is to emphasize that it is your opinion.
And can you please show the court where to begin to use this opinion?
I can.
Permission to have you step down.
You can comment, use terms such as it appears, which lends it to, which implies that it's his interpretation of events and not that. it's also up here, where it's referring to the ticker that runs along the bottom of the screen, it says that you may be the shooter. That leaves a great deal of uncertainty, which also lends itself to being impaired. There are several other cases of such terminology in this report.
And in your professional opinion, do you view words like maybe or it appears to be direct?